All right. Good morning, everyone. And I welcome you to St. Luke's United Methodist Church, a historic church in Jefferson Barracks. And it's wonderful to have you join us here on campus, both here and in the Parkhurst overflow, and also joining us online. Thank you so much for being a part of worship on this day. Today, we're excited to be able to meet on campus. We've done a lot of things here to make sure that everyone is safe, and we will continue to do so into the future. One of the things that we're all about at St. Luke's United Methodist Church is we're a mission-minded church. Any amens out there?
Amen.
Amen. That's right. We are a church that really loves the Lord and loves to serve other people. And today our mission moment comes to us. Deb Lampy's coming, and we have some exciting news to share from the Resell It Show.
Well, thank you for all the volunteers for the Maureen Abel Resell It Shop, who is a mission for the community to bringing reasonable priced items. And thank you so much for all the volunteers this week that helped us open on Wednesday. Our first day, we had made $147, and I'm sure yesterday we probably made over $100 as well. So thank you. What we're trying to do is have a one-way in and one-way out. Instead of coming in the front door, we're coming in off the parking lot and greeting people to encourage them to wear their masks, as well as having hand sanitizer there for them. Encouraged only a few people in the shop at a time, and then our overflow obviously is in the gym so they can browse that area as well, which there are a lot of 50-cent items in there because we didn't have our 25-cent sale. So if you want to get the best of the best of the 25-cent sale, you can go get it for 50 cents now. And that 25-cent sale will be coming up on July 11th. So you can look for the, I'm sure that was in the newsletter, as well as that. So, and I hope you all know that we do give 10% of our profits to the church, as well as missions around the St. Louis area and around the world. So thank you all again for all your generous donations and volunteers. Thank you.
I want to say thanks to not only Deb, but all of the volunteers and workers and all of you, because I know many of you have donated items and have done a beautiful job to help us to reach out in mission through the Maureen Abel Reselling Shop. I do remind everyone that we are still in construction here at St. Luke's, so part of our building over here is a hard hat zone only. So in lieu of that, our building team chair, John Newman, has put together a slideshow for you. If you're curious about how things are progressing, and they're progressing rapidly, there is a slideshow as you leave today. Make sure you check that out on the table behind our water fountain there. All right, let's go ahead and get to worshiping. We're going to ask that you remain seated. If you're singing, please leave your mask up. And if you're not, you can keep your mask down. Thank you.
So that is pretty clear. Take those masks off. No, yeah. Let's lift our voices in praise today. You folks over there in Parkhurst, I want to hear you. No cheating. Here we go. Today is the day. Oh, 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 oh. I'm casting my cares aside. I'm leaving my past behind. I'm setting my heart and mind on you, Jesus. I'm reaching my hands to yours. Believing that's all I'm for. Knowing that all. Tomorrow, I'm trusting in what you say. Today is the day.
Amen. What a great way to get us started today. Real upbeat. I love that. Today, as we go into a time of prayer together as a church family, we do want to remember our world today. We want to remember those that have had some recent outbreaks, especially out west, west of here. And so we want to continue to pray for God's provision for all of those families that are affected. Also, for those that are going through some seasonal allergies that are happening right now, grass pollen is taking over as we mow our yards, and so we want to pray for them also. Let's go before God, and let's have a little time of prayer together. Thank you, God. Today is a day that you have made. Today is a day for us to celebrate your presence in our life. Today is a day for us to be able to lift up our hearts in praise and thanksgiving for who you are. And so, Lord, as we've sung and as we are praying, Lord, we give you glory for everything that happens here today. Lord, we just give it over to you. We ask, Father, your blessing over this country of ours, over this world of ours, and Lord, where there is strife, I pray for your healing. Lord, where there is sickness, I pray for your healing. Lord, where there is places where people do not feel safe, I pray for your protection. And Lord, I thank you and praise you so much because you have provided so many blessings in our life. Even during a tough time like this, we can see the many blessings that you have for us. Lord, the blessings of our church family. Lord, the blessings of being able to use technology to reach out to many that maybe we couldn't reach before. Lord, we're thankful for that blessing. Lord, we're thankful for the blessing of the sun on our shoulders. And Lord, there may be a Sahara sandstorm overhead, but we know that beyond that, we can count on your presence in this world and in our life. And so with that, we give you thanksgiving and praise. Lord, draw us close to your word today. Help us to glean from it what you would have us through your Holy Spirit to teach. And I pray that your blessing be upon it. In Jesus' precious name we pray. As Jesus taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Folks, you're in for a real treat today. We have some special music. Emily Mihai is coming, and we want to welcome her. Let's welcome her.
I absolutely beautiful.
Amen.
It's time for us to do our part. So let's join our voices together again, please, as we sing, "You Are Mine."
We come to a time to dive into the Word of God today. Let's just begin with a time of prayer. God, as we have come before you, we know that there are times in our lives that are difficult. This may be one of those. As we struggle through things that go on that we have no control over, as we have emotional issues that just strangle us and have a hold over us, I pray, Father, for your strength. I pray, Father, for your guidance through your Holy Spirit to help us travel through difficult times in our life. Lord, may your word reveal to us the ultimate joy that we can have, even in times such as this. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Today I'm going to continue in our sermon series on spiritual maturity. And what I'd like to do is talk a little bit about that emotional component. Anybody here ever struggle with your emotions? Anybody here ever heard it kind of described as a roller coaster? Okay, have we ever felt like we've been on a roller coaster with some ups, some downs, and some just kind of blah? Some days go that way. So, I don't know about you, but I'm hoping that some of you, if you can see the screen behind me, there's depictions of people that are having angry moments. That's an emotion, isn't it? There's some people having some anxiety. I don't know what that little boy is going through up there. But he's really going through something. There's some pictures here that describe times where we go through a depression or one of those lower times in our emotional life. And there are times, and there's some bitterness that you'll see depicted here. Folks, emotions is a part of our everyday life. In how we, as brothers and sisters in Christ, how we deal with those emotions is an important part of our witness, because we know that that's really, these kind of emotions are not what God wants for us. So what does God want for us? I think it's easy for you to see on the screen now that there are the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Once Christ comes to live inside of our heart and our life, we are able then to tap into some different kind of emotions. Even when things are going crazy around us, we can still have joy. Even when things are going crazy around us, you know, we can still have peace. It's the peace that passes all understanding. I mean, sometimes we can't, our brains have a hard time going into peaceful mode, right? Other times, it's easy for us to see how we can become impatient, because we're having to wait quite a bit, aren't we? Even in life. Right now, it seems like a time of waiting. So I want you to think about all of those things, gentleness, kindness, self-control, all of those things. And those are the type of things God wants for your life. So how do we get from a place where we're angry, a place where we're bitter, a place where we have a lot of anxiety, how do we get from that place to get to a place where we can experience some of these things God wants us to experience? So I'd like for us to think about some of the ways that the Bible teaches us on this. But before I do that, Dr. Neil Anderson came up with this quote, and I wanted to share it with you because I thought it was important for us on this day to remember what these emotions do for us. And Dr. Anderson said these words. He said, "Your emotions play a major role in the process of renewing your mind. In a general sense, your emotions are a product of your thought life. If you're not thinking right, if your mind is not being renewed, if you're not perceiving God and His Word properly, it will show up in your emotional life." I mean, how many of us get trapped into this? I'm sorry, there's no better way for me to describe it other than a toilet bowl. Okay, I'm sorry, you haven't heard this in a sermon. But how many of you know when you flush a toilet, it kind of swirls, and what is up there kind of goes somewhere else? Y'all remember that? Okay. So that's the way our emotional thought life can go. And it can just go downward in a spiral. And so I want us to think about how that, in Dr. Anderson's picture here is a wonderful picture, because it helps us to see, man, if we're not thinking right, if we got stinking thinking going on, that's a hillbilly terminology, then we can't always process our emotions correctly, and our emotions can go the wrong way. So Folks, that is the first foothold that Satan can put on your life. When we're not thinking right, and we're not renewing our minds and transforming according to the way God wants us to do in the book of Romans, one of the things that is happening is that Satan can grab hold of us and not let us go. There are times when in our thought life, if we're not thinking right, we can say that God is the source of our problems. No hands, but has anybody here ever blamed God for anything? There are times when even the best of us kind of wonder, and we say that big word to God, why? Not hard. That's not wrong to say why. But what I'm saying is, when we go from the why to this is God's fault, that's when that problem comes in our emotions. We also get wrong perceptions. We can be poisoned toward God, and I'm afraid that some of our society is being poisoned toward God right now. I see it in the streets. I see it in the unrest. I see it in people that are not seeking God, but they're seeking other things. I want us to say, okay, where is God in all of this? Our feelings toward God get poisoned if we're having the wrong thinking about who God is in our life. The root of bitterness is something that needs to be gardened out. How many of you had a garden, either a flower garden or a garden with some kind of a vegetable in it? Some of you have. Okay, we got some gardeners in the crowd and probably online. The thing about it is, what would that garden look like if you never, ever pulled the weeds? What would happen to that garden? You'd see a weed garden, wouldn't you? Because the weed would take over the good things, the produce, or the flowers that you're trying to grow. So I believe that as a people of God, that we should remember that we've got to weed out bitterness in our life. We've got to take it up by the roots and allow us, as the people of God, to not blame God for everything that comes along. That's when we get callous toward God. And so I want us to think about that. The weeds are the bitterness. Okay? I've got a great example, and that example is one of the greatest prophets that was in the Bible, and that was the prophet Jeremiah. You see, God gave him a message, and that message was not a very popular message. In fact, Jeremiah was one that said, hey, you know, this whole area is going to be not only destroyed, but it's going to be taken over by the Babylonians, and, you know, your heart was not right. And so here's poor Jeremiah. And the king at the time actually arrested him for what he had to say. And he was thrown into captivity because they didn't want to hear it anymore. That wasn't the news the king wanted to have out with the people, but it was the news God wanted Jeremiah to share. So the emotions that were going on with Jeremiah is he cared so much for the people, and he wanted to warn them, and he wanted them to turn from their evil and wicked ways. But yet, you know what the story was. Jeremiah's predictions actually came true. And here is, in the book of Jeremiah, it talks about, I remember my affliction and my wandering, the bitterness and the gall. I well remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we're not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will wait for him. This is out of that book of Lamentations, and you know what a lament is. A lament is crying out to God about what's going on in Jeremiah's life. And this encapsulates those emotions that Jeremiah was having. It was bitterness and gall, and it was tough because of what God had asked him to do. But yet, what renewed his faith, what renewed his spirit, what renewed his emotions was all key in his relationship that would never change even during dark or tough times. Folks, you may be facing a dark or tough time. Our world may be facing a dark or tough time, but just like Jeremiah, great is the faithfulness of God, amen. We can count on God. Some of you musicians are seeing that this is where that song, Great is Thy Faithfulness, comes from. It's from Jeremiah's lament. Jeremiah was expressing how tough life was. But the Lord is his portion. Is the Lord your portion today? Is the Lord who is helping you through all of this? And yes, there are times we have to wait to get through those tough times in our life. But God, the Lord God, is always there. So let's kind of dive a little deeper, because you and I, as human beings, emotions are a part of our life, okay? We have lots of ways that happens every day. And so we need to figure out, okay, how is it that you and I can choose to respond? Well, some, and many, I think, suppress their emotions. Anybody ever try to hide an emotion? Maybe a time or two in your life, maybe a time or two this week. Okay. And it's easy for us to say, I'm going to cover this up. Okay, I'm going to cover up my emotions, and I'm going to have this conscious denial of the feelings that I have about the struggles I'm going through. How many of you have ever heard of the ostrich in the sand? Anybody? What did the ostrich do? Ostrich dug his head down in the sand, so kind of denying that anything was going on around, right? So we don't want that kind of thing. Another way we express our emotions is kind of some indiscriminate type of expressions. In other words, whoever will listen to our troubles, we just blurt it out to anyone and anybody at any time, okay? You may know somebody like that. Sometimes, you know, it's difficult when you have so much pent up, not to just let it spew, all right? And that's a difficult thing. That's a difficult pattern to get out of. And finally, we can acknowledge our emotions. We can claim them, okay? We can say, I own this, all right? Not that God caused this. Remember our former discussion? No. I own this. This is my frustration right now. And so we can get real before God. And maybe a few of our close friends, maybe we can express to them our true feelings, and that's a healthier thing that way than the other ways. So emotions are something that we have to deal with. It's something we can't forget. So the first thing we've got to do is we've got to know when we are carrying too much emotional baggage around in our life. And there's times we've got to evaluate that, right? This picture kind of talks about how resentments and guilt and shame and secrets and hang-ups and habits can jump into our emotions and create who we are because we're dealing with all of that. Our previous life history will give us, some of us, how many of you have a past? Okay, that's a unanimous thing, right? You all have a past. That is what helps form us, okay, in the way that we have handled things in our past. And it's part of our past history is part of how we will react to our emotional baggage. So everything that we are is a product of everything that we have gone through. Also, the present events, we got a few things going on. I looked in my closet today and I thought, okay, how can I dress like a Sahara dust storm? I was trying to find something that would really match. They say that this hasn't happened for 500 years, so I thought it was like sandblasting God style, but that's okay. You know, we think about all the stuff we're going through. We're going through a pandemic, aren't we? Still? Okay, we thought we'd be over it by now. That's an emotional thing. Our relationships, and I will say that this summer, late summer, I'm going to do a whole series that I wrote about how we can build our relationships again. So difficult to feel like we're separated from each other. And so I wrote a sermon series, I think that one hits in September. And our relationships are so important, and we don't want to lose those or lose sight of those, even when we're going through some different restrictions. We have some, you know what I'm talking about when I say knee-jerk reactions? Okay, you remember when you went to the doctor's office and they had that crazy little triangular hammer and they came after you? You remember that? They were seeing what your nervous response was. We have an emotional response similar to that, okay? No one's coming to beat us with a hammer on their knee, thank God, but we still have a primary emotional response to everything that hits us. So it's something that we've got to be aware of, that maybe that response isn't the healthiest response. Maybe we need to sit down and think about it. Mental evaluation is something that helps us to be able to process, and it's very difficult to process when we're under emotional duress, right? Very difficult. So for us to begin to manage those emotions, what we've got to do is we've got to be able to say, think through and see the bigger picture. Sometimes for us to see how God is protecting us, we need to see God's bigger picture of provision over our lives, right? So we got to stop and think through that. And also, once we've thought through it, then we're going to have a secondary response. And maybe that mountain that we thought it was just a molehill. You know what I'm talking about? That maybe it wasn't as big of a thing, but it sure seemed like it at the time. So one of the things I want to encourage us to do is look at how we will process, how we look beyond, look and see God's blessings over us, even when we're going through tough times, and then react from there. Our past experiences are various, okay? All of us have different experiences, but maybe some of these will hit because there are times when we have experienced negative things. Has your past always been positive? Every single second of your life, has it always been positive? I don't know that anybody on this planet can say that every second of their life has been totally positive. So when we are put up against negative things, our first thing is the desire to be set free from the negativity of our past, okay? That's the first thing. Then we can sit down and we can evaluate with who we are now, okay? Not who we were when that happened back in our past. Sometimes we like to live in our past. You ever heard of somebody that just keeps reliving it and won't move beyond it? We need to move beyond it into where we are now, because now when we evaluate it, we might be able to respond emotionally with a better response. I think the scripture teaches us in 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, the 17th verse, it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. So that transformation of our hearts and our minds, who we are now, is better able to handle what we have been through in the past. We've got to forgive folks